plant I'm discussing today is the highest produced crop in the United States, is used for things from feeding cows to making sweeteners, is in the grass family, and was domesticated thousands of years ago. If that, or you know the title of the video, weren't enough of a hint, I'm talking about corn. Corn, also known as maize, was domesticated from a plant called teosinte, somewhere between 6,000 and 10,000 years ago. Teosinte is rather unlike the tasty corn we're used to. Its ears are small and tough, with only a few kernels. The plant itself is bushy and sprawling, unlike the neat lines of tall corn we know today. So maize is very different from its ancestor, so much so that at first botanists didn't believe they were even related. It wasn't until genetic analysis showed the similarity between the two plants that the relationship became apparent, along with some other really cool analyses, like looking at phytoliths. Phytoliths are microscopic deposits of silica or calcium oxalate that accumulate between the cells of the plant. They vary in shape depending on the species of the plant and survive for thousands of years, even after the plant is long gone. So scientists can look at sediments and analyze the phytoliths in them, identifying whether domesticated maize was present during a particular time period. This was one of the ways they determined that corn is an ancient crop. Basically, they used tiny silica fragments from thousands of years ago to learn about corn. Science is really cool. Maize was likely domesticated in what is modern-day Mexico by ancient farmers who skillfully and selectively bred wild maize. Years of breeding yielded modern-day maize, scientific name Zea maize. It is a grass, so it is in the family Poaceae, and it grows several meters tall. Its flowers come in two varieties, male flowers, which grow at the top of the plant and are called tassels, and female flowers, which are halfway down the plant and called the ear. They have long styles called silk, which you may be familiar with from husking corn. Each ovule on that ear has the potential to become a corn kernel, as many as 1,000. But first, that ovule must be fertilized. I talk about pollination a lot on this channel, but maize is one of those plants that doesn't really require pollinators to bear fruit. Instead, the tassels produce huge amounts of pollen that is carried on the wind, meaning those large fields of corn are perfect for pollination. Once fertilized, corn cobs form from the ear, yielding the delicious corn we know so well. And corn is used for far more than just human consumption. In fact, most corn produced goes toward livestock feed. It's also used to produce ethanol and the famous high fructose corn syrup. I mentioned that corn is the most dominant crop in the United States. Every year, close to 100 million acres of corn are planted. So corn is big business. And much of the drive for more corn and higher yields is caused by the ethanol industry. In addition to its economic importance and long history, corn is well known for something else: its prominence as a GMO. A GMO is a genetically modified organism, aka an organism that has had its genes altered to accomplish a specific goal. In many cases, this is done by adding the gene from one organism to another to help with things like pest resistance, drought tolerance, or chemical treatment resistance. There are many GMO varieties of corn. As of 2015, 33 varieties of it were approved for production in the United States. One example of these many, many varieties is BT corn, which was engineered to be resistant to lepidopteran larvae like the European corn borer, Austrinia nubilalis. These hungry caterpillars can destroy corn crops by chewing through the stalks, leaves, and fruit of the plant. BT corn has been engineered to contain a gene from a soil bacterium, Bacillus thuringiensis. I'll put it on the screen. This gene allows the corn to produce a crystal protein, a toxin to lepidopterans and some other groups of insects, making it resistant to the busy mouths of larvae. Like I said, this is only one example of a trait that has been engineered into GMO corn. Some varieties even have more than one trait added in, making them a stacked variety. Adoption of GMO crop plants has been skyrocketing. Between 2000 and 2013, usage of GMO corn went from comprising less than 10% of the acreage in the US to over 80%, depending on the variety. If you'd like to learn more information about the use and analysis of GMO crops, I encourage you to check out some of the sources in the description. And there you have it, a brief primer on corn, the world's top crop. This video is the first in a series that I'm calling Big Agriculture, where I'll be going over lots of different crops that are extremely important in the world. That'll include rice, coffee, all sorts of things. If there's a crop you'd like to hear about, please do let me know about it in the comments. If you'd like to see more videos in this Big Ag series, please hit the thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. Again, if you have any questions, throw those in the comments. I'd love to hear from you. And if you'd like to support Brilliant Botany, you can do so by becoming a patron over on Patreon. Go to the link in the description, give a monthly monthly amount as little as a dollar, and you get awesome perks in return while helping Brilliant Botany grow. You can also check out the link in the description for merch, like awesome stickers, hats, and more stuff coming soon. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next week.